So let's do an analysis on some home prices I collected here. So there are houses for sale in Hermiston this month. And we can kind of look at each month like a random sample of house prices in a particular area. So let's get the shareable link for those of you either live or in the future. Notice my link is restricted. So I want to make sure that anyone with the link can view it or copy it. And for those of you live, here it is in the chat. And for those in the future, check out the description underneath the video for a link to this file. So you can either just watch, follow along, or play with this on your own at the same time. So there's no particular order to these numbers. I didn't collect any other information about the houses for sale, but I have 31 numbers in my list here. Usually I like to have them in order. So if I wanted to sort these from the top, control shift down arrow will look for the bottom. And then I want to do data. The fourth option here, or the fifth one, sort range. It's got a header row, so that stays at the top. And then I'm gonna go smallest to largest. Let's see, we have company. Welcome, Amy.
Hello.
And then I'm going to put in the chat, we just started a new topic, a spreadsheet to work with, the one I have on display right now. So if you check out the chat, you'll get a link to this file.
Thank you.
Yep. And you could either just follow along watching, or you could make a copy of it to play with. All right, so we got both of you in there right now. So again, these are Hermiston home prices in thousands that I collected this month. And I just wanna analyze this. So, you know, a friend of mine's looking for a house, maybe Pendleton, maybe Hermiston. I can say, well, I know a little bit about Hermiston. So what can I tell them about the Hermiston home prices currently? So I want the summary statistics, the standard ones. Then we'll check for outliers, we'll make a histogram, we'll make a box plot, just to get more practice with that. So for the summary statistics, the ones I usually get are count, how many are there, the mean, standard deviation, let's just abbreviate that as STDV. And I'm going to make some, just a little bit of space there. After that, I'm going to go for the five number summary. So the min, Q1, min, Q3, and max. Other related things to that is we'll find the range, another measure of spread, and the IQR. And we'll come back and use the IQR and the mean and the standard deviation to see if any of these prices are unusually high or unusually low compared to the rest, or if they're all in kind of the usual category. Every data set's different. So making these, count is just count. And since the only thing I have in column A is the name of the numbers and the numbers, I can just click on the column A. And it says grab everything in column A that's a number and try to count it. Counted 31 numbers. Mean is average. There's a bunch of different ones. We just want average, ignoring text. So we can just click on the column heading. Notice I didn't enter my, close my parentheses. That was being lazy. I probably should have. Excel freaks out about it. Google does not. It says they probably meant to close the parentheses and does it for me. So notice if I look back here, Google closed it for me. That was kind of naughty of me. STD, there's a whole bunch of standard deviations. We want dot S or sample. We talked about how standard deviation is calculated the other day. It's different for a sample than a population. This is definitely a sample. Now, as far as rounding goes, it looks like I have one decimal place at most in my numbers. So I would round these to two decimal places. We always go one more than the data. Well, those are interesting numbers. Bunch of ways to get the min. We're just going to use the min option. Data, quartile, recommended one is quartile inclusive, INC, data. And then which quartile do you want? There's five of them. We want quartile one, the end of the first quarter. Median, we'll just use the median command. Quartile three, we have to use the quartile command. Well, we don't have to, but we're going to. Data, comma, third, three for third quartile, and max. That's just max. All right, so we have the basic calculations there, and then we're going to add on to this by finding the range. What's the distance between the smallest and the largest? So equals max minus min. If you need to repeat, me to repeat something, let me know. And IQR is the distance between the first and third quartile. So that would always be Q3 minus Q1. Once I have those, I'm gonna make a histogram, and then along with the histogram, I'm gonna throw in a box plot. Instead of making the box plot by hand today, I'm gonna use StatKey to make a box plot. And so it just makes a drawing of one for you instead of you making it yourself, which is sometimes nice to get on a computer screen. To get the histogram, we can just highlight the column, since the only thing in the column is the title and the numbers, and then say Google make me a chart, the insert chart button. So it's making a column chart, which is not meaningful at all. All it is the height showing the price in thousands of each home in order from smallest to largest. It doesn't really tell me anything. So that's not a meaningful chart. I want a histogram. Let's see, Google chose to give me five columns. Usually we go for 6 to 20, but 5 is okay. And it's jumping by 130,000. I think I'm gonna do that a little different. And there's no best histogram, so you just gotta go play. And the two ways we play with the histogram are changing the bucket size, and then change in Google at least, and changing where we start and or end. So usually I just start with changing the bucket size. Instead of auto, I'm gonna try, first I'll try 100,000, but that seems like a pretty big range. Now 100 here means 100,000 because my prices are in thousands. So just, that's an important note. Title at the top says prices in thousands. So 193 is really 193,000. So that's why I call this 100,000 instead of 100. Okay. You know, that's not bad. I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 groups. That's okay. I was thinking I might want to have a bucket size of 50, jump by 50,000. That's not bad either. It's a little messier. Let's see, what is the standard deviation? It is around 100,000, 111. Okay, so I guess I'm gonna go with that first one I made. I'm gonna go with a bucket size of 100. And sometimes I'm not sure and I need to look at them side by side. So if you want to see two histograms together, I'm just going to shrink this one a little to fit two together. I make one and then I just grab the data again and say, make another. And then I'm going to go customize histogram and I'm going to put the 100 in there for comparison. Just move this over and resize it to kind of match. So I have a couple different options. I really like them both. And so sometimes when I'm doing data analysis like this, I might have more than one histogram because they both tell me slightly different things. Okay. I think in the end, I like this one better right here. So I'm gonna just move this around. Let's put you off to the side. Let's say we're there for now. You back up here. Let's say I want a little bit of space. I want you bigger. Not big enough? Sure. All right. Often the computer guesses at titles based on any labels that you highlighted. So I'm going to change this a little bit. This is Hermiston House. Prices, let's see, April, bad, price devices are in thousands. That's a good thing to note. And then this is what's called a frequency histogram. So often this vertical column, this vertical axis would be labeled frequency. But again, most people aren't quite sure what you mean by frequency. And you might say frequency means count. And they might say, well, what are you counting? That's the better name. So vertical axis, I'm counting houses. So this is counting the number of houses in each group. So I'm just going to call it number of houses. OK, so there is my histogram. Pretty happy with that. Next, I want to draw on it. So do I want to draw on it? No, I don't want to draw on it yet. I want to get a box plot. So a box plot is a graph based on the five-number summary. And just a note about the five-number summary, the quartiles in particular, it's not an agreed-upon calculation worldwide. So Google and Excel do it one way. People that use other statistical packages out there, and there's a lot of them, might do it a different way. And StatKey does it a different way. There's a slightly different way of doing it by hand. So there's all these different methods of doing them. What that means is, if you do this calculation on the same set of data and somebody else does it with a different software package, they might have slightly different numbers for Q1 and Q3. This comes up as a problem with the homework, like your Q1 and Q3, the computer doesn't like it, or your IQR. Message me from the problem and I'll try to figure out what's going on. And tell me how you calculated those numbers too. If you used a TI or if you used a spreadsheet or some other program like StatKey. Because they won't agree with each other on Q1 and Q3 for most data sets. All right, with that in mind, what we're going to do is we'll get a box plot from StatKey. To do so, highlight the data and only the data. Don't highlight the whole column. That might mess up the program because there's a ton of empty stuff underneath. So I want the data and the title at the top. And then I'm just going to do a search for StatKey, and then I'll share the link with you through the chat or through the description of the video on YouTube. Check out the chat now, you should see the link to StatKey. And I am working with one quantitative variable, right? Those are house prices, their numbers, their quantities. I only have one variable. And then I just want to edit the data to replace theirs. So from StatKey, one quantitative variable, just select edit data, and then highlight and delete their data. Paste yours in. Oops, I forgot I copied something in between. I'm gonna go back and get it. Copy and paste. Before you hit okay, double check that it's okay to have these boxes checked or not. So first column with identifier. I do not have any column in front of this identifying the 350 or the 400, like maybe the address of the house or something like that, or the square footage. So I have no first column identifiers. Do I have a header row? The answer is yes, I have prices in thousands at the top. If you didn't copy that header row and it's just a number up there like 18.86.9, then you would uncheck this box. Not having these boxes checked right will either lead the computer to just say, I don't get it, or to have a wrong result. So make sure you check the right boxes there. And then we just want to switch to box plot. So the box plot here is showing me that there are some outliers. There's a few of them. One unusually low priced house, and then one, two, three unusually high priced houses compared to the rest. So instead of having the whisker go all the way out to the max, StatKey makes that cutoff based on 1.5 times the RQR and says, these guys are a little far from that middle box than the rest of the data. Q1 here, 287.45, based on my spreadsheet. Oh, that matches. The other one, 369 versus 369. Okay, they match for this data set. That's cool. So Q1 and Q3 won't always match, but they should be close. I want to put this in my spreadsheet. The only way to do that is by taking a screenshot. And screenshot techniques are different whether you're using a Windows computer, a Chromebook, or a Mac. So I'm going to show on a Windows computer. If you're not sure how to do it on your computer, I can help you figure it out. In Windows, I want the snipping tool. Sometimes it's called Snip and Sketch. So either select Snipping Tool or Snip and Sketch if you're on Windows like me. The mode should be rectangular and then just new. The screen will gray out and then you just draw a rectangle on what you want to keep. And I want the scale at the bottom, because what I want to do is I want to line up those numbers at the bottom with the numbers at the bottom of my histogram. And then I can just copy and paste it in here. All right, so it came in huge, so I'm just going to shrink it down a little bit and then try to, ooh, interesting, it's moving around. So first shrink it, and what we want to do is we want to line up numbers at the bottom here. So let's see. So these numbers are going to be a little tricky to line up because I chose a scale here that StatKey did not. Let's see, 50, 150, well, 100 would be right in the middle. So that line for 100 should be right there. And then 700, maybe I'll do 600. Oh, did I do weird stuff? 50 to 150, 150 to 250, no, that's okay. 450 to 550, so 500 would be in between. Okay, 600 would be right in between here. So I just want to resize that some more so that the line on my box plot for 600 falls right in the middle of 550 and 650. Yeah, so these lines should fall in the middle of each of those. So find a way to line these two up. Okay, that's pretty good there. So it's a combination of moving it around and then grabbing corners on each side to resize it. You can resize this way, but that distorts the image. And so sometimes it's not bad to distort it. Like I wish this was not quite as tall. I wish the box plot looked more like that, but now those numbers at the bottom are fuzzy and those points are kind of fuzzy, which I don't really like, but it's a possibility. And that looks pretty good. All right, so, and I can't do it with that distortion. That's a little better. So what we should see is anywhere we have a tall stack, we should have a narrow quarter on our box plot. When I draw a box plot, I usually draw the whisker all the way out to the max over here on the right. And so anytime I see a long quarter like that, then that means the data is more spread out. I should see shorter stacks in the histogram. And I am going to bring all this into my drawing pad just to sketch out a few things and talk about outliers. Let's see, where's my notes? And then once I get some information about outliers, then I can kind of describe what this data set's like so I could share it with somebody else. So my friend who's in the market for a house, he doesn't want to see all this stuff I did. And he might not even want to see the graphs. He just wants me to tell him some stuff about what I think about the range of house prices. Add it to a new page. And then I also need those summary statistics and a couple more calculations. So some calculations I need to continue is based on the IQR, I can come up with a lower and an upper boundary for outliers. And also based on the mean and the standard deviation, I can do the same. So I'm gonna make a little more room here by dragging this stuff down there. So from the mean and the standard deviation, I'm gonna get a lower number and an upper number for what's usual. Same thing for IQR, a lower, based on those. Those won't always agree, as we saw in another example. So for the mean and standard deviation, that's always take your mean minus two standard deviations, and then take your mean again and add two standard deviations. So here, take the mean of 333,000, subtract two times that standard deviation of 111,000. So I get 110 roughly, and then the upper from the mean add two times the standard deviation. And so So I get, according to this data, the usual house price, 95% of house prices are going to be somewhere between 110,000 and 557,000. IQR rules a little different. It's not always going to agree. To calculate the lower here, we take Q1, subtract 1.5 times the IQR for the lower edge of what's usual, and the upper is going to be Q3 plus 1.5 times that IQR. And just notice something about these two sets of calculations. Both calculations need some place to say, hey, the middle of data is about here. And then we're just gonna look out to the edge a little bit to say what's usual. So in this case, Q1 and Q3 means make the box the middle of the data, and then look a little bit out to the right and the left to make boundaries of what we think is usual. The mean and the standard deviation, instead of using IQR as spread and the box as the middle, that says let's make the mean the middle and use the standard deviation to look to the right and look to the left. So when you're looking for outliers, you either use the mean and the standard deviation together, or you use Q1 and Q3, which make the IQR and make that range there. So let's make this calculation and we'll draw it into the picture. So Q1, again, be careful to click in the right spots. 1.5 times the IQR. And then the upper would be Q3 plus 1.5 times the IQR. And I get a slightly different set of numbers. According to the box plot, the claim is that housing prices between 165 and 491,000 are what you find most of the time. Outside of that are unusually low or unusually high. So I'm just going to draw that in here. And I guess I need pretty much all of these. Summary statistics, I have my graphs, and then I'm just going to by hand draw on this so I can think about it a little more. So let's say, my pen stopped working, come on, there you go. Let's say in red, we'll use the mean and the STD to make our marks. So I'll make those up here. So 110,000 is gonna be right about here. And then 556,000 is just going to be a little past here, so maybe right about there. So this right here, from these two red, one, this red mark to that red mark, that's the usual 95% of housing prices should be in that range right there. Outside of that is unusual. And we do have some numbers that were outside of that. So for example, here I have 110,000, but the min was 86. So for sure the minimum is unusually low compared to the rest. Let's do green on the box plot here for these numbers. 165 is going to be about here-ish, and then 491, pretty close to 500, probably about there. So this is the usual range on the box plot from here to about there. Anything outside of that is unusual. So this one right there is unusually low. And these three, there were one, two, and a third one there back in StatKey. So double check, and we can look at the data too to see that. But in StatKey, when I point to this, it actually tells me which numbers there are with these asterisks. So sometimes I also like to put that in my data. So let's see. 110, there was only one number low based on 110. Oops. So let's make that one yellow. So that wasn't unusually low. And then this one said for low, 165 was cut off, and that's the only one below 165. So it's based on both accounts, it's an outlier. 556 and 491 the other way. So 449, then 520. So the both the 491 and the 556. Oh, so only this one right here, based on the upper, is outside. So maybe I'll make that one dark red. And then 491 puts these two as outliers also. And again, I mentioned before, the methods don't always agree, which is fine, just the way it is. Make that light red. Yeah, so we found one housing price that was unusually low here, and we found three or one, depending on which measure you look at, that are unusually high. What else can we say about this? Well, looking at this right here, it's got a relatively symmetric bell shape. And remember, we did make another graph. So here's kind of a almost symmetric bell. What do you see a tail here? Is the tail to the left or the right in terms of skewness?
Would it be the right?
Yeah, I'm leaning toward the right on that. When I look at this one right here, there's kind of a tail there, kind of a tail there. This one's a little more pronounced on the right. Yeah, so I would lean toward this data is skewed right. And I think the box plot helps emphasize that too. There's a little more of a longer stretch in that whisker out to the right. Another way we compare skewness right or left is by looking where the mean is with respect to the median, because the mean is more affected by the extreme values, the numbers on the edge of the data set. So let's go to the picture I was drawing here. So let's see, the median was 300. So I'm gonna graph the median in green up here. So 300 is right in the middle there. So that's M, the median. And then the mean, I'll do that one in red. That one's the symbol X with a bar over it, X bar. That's 333. Notice that is a little bit to the right. So that's probably about right here. So there's my X bar. So the bigger numbers are pulling the mean away from the median. So this is more evidence that the data is skewed to the right because of this higher house price there. Okay, could be these two affect a little bit, but I think this is the culprit right here. There's one house in this category right there that's over 650,000. So somebody might say, well, you know, that's pretty unusual. We should just take that out of the data set. And really the data set for the average buyer is just this stuff right here. So that's something that would go in my description of the housing prices. So let's start on a description here. So let's see, what do I wanna say? I think I might start with the 95% rule. So I could say the majority of housing prices are between 110,000 and 557,000, if we round that. And I could go a little farther with that by talking about the IQR. So from Q1 to Q3, that's the middle 50%, right? So a reminder about a box plot here. So just a little educational reminder. Each quarter, so the first quarter goes from the min up to the edge of Q1. So 25% of the data lives in this range right here. Oops. The next 25% lives in this little tiny wedge right there. So 25% of the house prices are between 287,000 and 300,000. So that's an interesting thing to note. That's a pretty narrow slice. The middle 50%, so the next 25% is this distance right here. That's another 25%. And the upper 25% of houses are from this 369,000 all the way over to that max of 700,000 really. So that's 25% too. So then I have to decide, like, what, I don't want to say too much and I don't want to say too little. So a couple things that catch my eye here are that little narrow wedge there, that 25%, a quarter of houses are between 287,000 and 300,000, right? That's interesting. And the middle price is 300,000 here, 300,000 here. Yeah, so I could say the average house price is around 300,000, maybe a little bit more. Is another thing I could add here. Since I talked about, like, most houses are between 110 and 55, I might be a little bit more specific about that middle 50%. Starting to do that here, and then I distracted myself. There's so many interesting things to say about this once you start thinking about it. So I think I'd include that. Majority of houses for sale in Hermiston are between 110,000 and 557,000. Maybe say with middle 50% between, and that's the 287 to 369. I'm going to put a K there, abbreviation for 1,000 for now. It's kind of just a rough draft of my ideas. And 369. The average house price. Is about 300,000. And again, when people talk about average, sometimes they're talking about the median when they say average, sometimes they're talking about the mean, it kind of depends. Let me give you a more extreme situation to think about that. Suppose in my block, houses have the following prices, 200,000, 200,000, 200,000. We got a bunch of small two bedroom houses in my neighborhood. And there's one big house in the middle, which just sold for 600,000. Right. If you look at these numbers in order, 200,000 is the median. Right. If I add them all up, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 14, let's see, with two zeros, oops, too many zeros, K divided by 5, let's see how many times does 5 go into 14, 2, 7, average house price is about, if I add them up, divide by 5, I get 270,000. This is the mean. Which is a better description of the average house in my neighborhood? 70,000 is a lot more than 200,000, right? I have a friend who's looking for a house. He wants to spend about 200,000. If I say, well, the average house price in my neighborhood is 200,000, he's going to say, man, your neighborhood is way out of my price range. I can't afford an extra 70,000. But the reality is that everyone's just about 200,000 really, and there's just this one oddball that's throwing it off. So with this data set, I would say the median is a better measure of the middle than the mean. So I would say, no, the average house price really is about 200,000. You get this one outlier here. So I don't have to take the $600,000 house out of the data set. I'm just gonna use the mean over the median because this is really skewing it right dramatically. So just something to think about. Oops. All right, so let's see. What are some other things we could say? Do you guys have any ideas that I haven't mentioned about what we see here? I haven't talked about unusually high or unusually low yet, so I would definitely put that in my description. What else could you say about this set of prices? Put you on the spot there. That's okay. It's hard when you're under pressure like that. Let's see. I've got the average house price. I got a little bit about the range in terms of middle 50%. I would add there seem to be some houses on the market that are unusually low in cost compared to the rest, and several that are unusually high in cost compared to the rest. There's another thing I could mention here for sure. Yeah. So every data set's different, new things come up. Okay, did I miss anything from my notes? Give me a sec to look. All right, I think that's pretty good. So next on the agenda is to take a look at your activity for the week. So this week's a little lighter than last week. Activity here. Is to take this file I have about home prices. So these home prices I collected in 2019. I grabbed housing prices in Pendleton and in Hermiston. I just need you to pick one. So either you can look at the home prices from Pendleton in the first tab, or you could switch to the second tab and use the prices in Hermiston. You do not need to do both right here. And then the summary statistics, like I calculated for the 2021 Hermiston prices, I want the standard set of calculations there. So the basic ones, count, mean, standard deviation, and then the five number summary, and then the range. Make a box plot. You could make the box plot by hand like I drew earlier, or you could use StatKey to make the box plot by just copying the data into StatKey. And then you could then, if you wish, put that in here using some screenshot tool. But again, with StatKey graphs, you have to use a screenshot to get it. Now, I like the Google histograms. I can change the colors if I want. That's a pretty blue, makes my day. But StatKey also does histograms. And I might have shown this in the last class. StatKey gives us this little slider here. We can change quickly the number of buckets. Remember, Google's default behavior is to change the width of a bucket. So they behave slightly differently, but I can get a bunch of different histograms to kind of think about how the data is spread out. Right? And we talk about the spread of the data in a graph, that's called the distribution. Right? So this is the distribution of data, looks slightly different depending on how I organize my buckets. If you want to take control over where it starts and ends, there's this set limit tool here where you can pick a better starting point, like Google picked 50,000 for me. Oops. 50, and then I could go up to 700,000 to make that nicer. And then in between, I can pick how many buckets did I get before. I got 7 buckets. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Let's see, 650. I might go up to 750 to make it easier. StatKey. With StatKey, you have to think about the start, the end, and the number of buckets instead of how wide you want the buckets to be. And so that's basically the same graph that I made in Google, but it's not as pretty colorful. But again, one nice thing about StatKey is this range of numbers at the bottom here will be the same for the histogram as the box plot. So it makes putting them together easier, but only just a tiny bit. You still have to do 2 screenshots there. And then based on the summary statistics, the histogram, make at least one histogram. You don't need to make more than one, but you can. I said at least one. Tell me something about the housing prices in Pendleton or Hermiston, kind of like I was trying to describe the 2021 housing prices. You're going to try and describe to me the 2019 housing prices. Then the other thing is the share your work. So for the share your work, just to get more practice, and I want everybody else to see everybody else's work. And this note is not true. We don't have enough people to do groups. So let me pull that out. I had a much larger class last year. Make sure I turned off group assignment there. So you're gonna repeat the same thing, but if you pick Pendleton last time, pick Hermiston this time. If you picked Hermiston last time, do Pendleton this time. And pretty much do the same thing. This one is a discussion, which means once you, am I lying again? It's not a discussion, I meant it to be. Well, I am having trouble pushing the right buttons in this program this week. Okay. Well, don't start this. I'm going to change it to a discussion. The reason being, everyone's going to make slightly different decisions on the histogram and say different things, and I wanted you to see what other people had to say. So I guess I'm going to have to unpublish this for now until I make it a discussion. All right, so the first one's private. That's just between you and me. The second one, everybody gets to see what you posted, just so we can see the variety of things people come up with. And the big things that people are going to come up with is we'll all have slightly different histograms. Maybe some of them will be the same because Google kind of picks for you at first for the distribution in the histogram. And then, but we're all going to say slightly different things about it. So we get to see the variety of things people come up with, which is kind of cool.
And so we're good just typing that on the spreadsheet and then attaching the spreadsheet in the discussion?
Yeah, the easiest thing to do is just put it all in the spreadsheet. That's what I would recommend.
Perfect.
And then just share your spreadsheet. All right, other questions? Okay.